Passing the torch. We the next generation since the day we were born.
We were meant to live free, this our family.
Always going for broke, and yet we live in the dream.
Hello everyone, and welcome to Go for Broke, National Education Center's newest segment, Living the Nisei Dream. My name is Staci, and I currently serve on Go for Broke, National Education Center's Board of Directors. Living the Nisei Dream explores the Nisei legacy, the notions of following your dreams, and to honor the stories of the Japanese-American veterans of World War II. It is now my pleasure to introduce you all to the host of Living the Nisei Dream, Sierra Katow. Born and raised in LA, Sierra is a Harvard-educated Japanese and Chinese-American Yonsei living her dream as a stand-up comedian.
Crazy Rich Asians came out, remember that? Hey, I wasn't in it, don't be racist.
Podcaster, television writer, and on-camera host. We are thrilled to have such a talented, enthusiastic, and bright young woman as the host of our newest segment. Sierra, thank you so much for bringing so much light and laughter to Living the Nisei Dream. What has been the best part about being the show's host?
It's been such a fun project. What I really enjoy about being the host is getting to dig into more about my family's history that I didn't already know. My Jichon was in the MIS, and learning about other Japanese American experiences that, like, you know, we can all relate because we have had the privilege of descending from people that really fought for us and really, like, made things happen. And so that's kind of also the spirit of the Nisei Dream.
So what I love about this series is it really has a wide range of individuals and subject matter, but really it's all coming together and sharing the same or similar story.
Yeah, if anything, I'm only learning that, like, the definition of the Nisei Dream is just ever expanding, and that, you know, my idea might be, oh, I get to work in entertainment and, like, say jokes on stage, and that's, like, my dream. We're not a monolith, right? We're just all over the place, contributing in our own way.
Is there anything you can share with us? Any common themes that are going to be coming up? What can you tell us so we have something to look forward to?
Yeah, no spoilers, right? We may leave our Southern California region. The possibilities are endless. Also a fun thread throughout, like a fun game that viewers can play is, ooh, let's see if we can spot Mitch Maki, president of Go for Broke National Education Center. Ever heard of him? He's going to be doing a little cameo in each episode, and that's called the Maki Mike, which is an awesome, cool, alliterative name for that.
It's kind of a Where's Waldo type thing. So when you spot something, you actually say the word Mike. So that's really a fun fact, and definitely something I think the viewers will be looking for. Everyone wants to spot Mitch. So.
So for this first episode, it was extremely fun because we got to work with a special guest. You'll totally know right away when you're watching this, but he's just like the most gregarious, fun person to hang out with. Being loud and being proud about Japanese American heritage, and it really embodies the spirit, I think, of Go for Broke. So please take a look.
Passing the torch.
We the next generation since the day we were born.
We were meant to live free, this our family.
Always going for broke, and yet we live in the dream.
The Nisei were the second generation Japanese Americans who were born in the U.S., they were American citizens, but who were incarcerated during World War II.
The coastal area has been banned to all Japs, aliens, and native born alike.
But many of them actually still fought for the U.S.
You fought not only the enemy, but you fought prejudice, and you won.
Fast forward, multiple generations later, I get to pursue a lot of dreams that, say, my grandparents weren't able to at the time.
We the next generation since the day we were born.
We were meant to live free, just our family.
Always going for broke.
Come join me on this journey where I get to sit down with other young Japanese Americans who are pursuing opportunities that only the Nisei made possible.
Always going for broke, and yet we live in the dream.
I'm Yonsei, for instance, which means fourth generation. I'm Sierra Katow, host of the show, and I'm here with Kaze Jones. He's a hip-hop MC, a school teacher, a multi-talented Shin-Nisei artist, and an all-around cool dude, but don't take my word for it.
So we go for
the 442 battle through Italy, France, and Germany. Joined with the 2nd and 100th band convergently. Executed all of a mission order so perfectly, 'cause we bled from purple hearts with a sense of urgency. We were
deemed 4C, that's enemy alien. Degraded by your neighbors, no longer we're homo sapiens. United States shunned us out, we were forsaken. So we pushed through so many barriers that we planned to break it. Every fortification we conquered, it was a statement. The knees said we go for broke, and we were patriots. Yo, we fought against prejudice, and we are living proof of what no other group of people should ever, ever go through.
I'm here with our very first guest, Mrs. Albert Koshimune, who is also known as Kaze Jones. Well, Kaze, we're actually in the exhibit where Go for Broke is based. This exhibit here, which is about the Japanese-American recipients of the Medal of Honor.
Yeah, Senator Daniel Inouye, he's definitely like my hero. He stormed up and he went with his Tommy gun in one hand, grenade in the other, but it just so happened, I think his arm got shot off. I was like, wow, what a true American hero.
What your music video is about, right, is that it does feel very much like, oh, you know, them having to prove their Americanness.
Yeah, I was just really inspired by the story. He was a Nisei, being a Nisei myself, very proud and very appreciative of what my forefathers did.
So we go for broke.
I was told I was born free. Feel the storm over forest sea. But it's flight outside.
So we go for broke.
The 442 and the suicide missions that they went on, you know, it was just something that I thought like a heroic moment in history. Yeah, it was a great way to connect with the Go for Broke National Education Center.
You're a man of many talents. You said you just came from teaching. You're a hip hop artist. How would you describe who you are?
It's like, it's conflicted. I still very much have the Japanese cultural side where I'm like, when I get in trouble, I'm getting yelled at in Japanese. Like, Nihongo, like the other side, I spent like the better half of the 90s trying to assimilate to American culture.
How did you find yourself as a rapper and a hip hop artist? Like, what drew you to that? Because that's kind of what I guess probably most people know you as, Kaze Jones the rapper.
I don't like to label myself as a rapper.
Oh, okay,
I'm like
got
an
it.
MC, like a linguist, right? For lyricism. And that came about because my little bro that passed away, he died in my arms when I was age 19, and I was like severely depressed. I was going to UC Irvine at the time, but then I withdrew from school. I was just in such a hot mess. Fraternity, my big bro in the fraternity, kicked down my door, dragged me out. That kind of snapped me out of it. And then he's like, dude, if you're so into hip hop, why don't you put your pain and your struggles like into lyrics? And then I wrote my first song from that depression. And then ever since then, I found such a big love for it. It saved my life. Hip hop saved my life, yeah.
Then your name, did you have this sort of revelation of like, this is sort of an alter ego, or this is
totally. So Kaze, for a short for kamikaze. So in seventh grade, we were learning about World War II, and then there was like a small little blurb about the kamikaze planes, and I was like the token Japanese guy out of all my like Caucasian friends, and they're like, oh, like you're kamikaze. And I was like, I don't think that's how you pronounce it, but yeah. And then from there, it went from kamikaze to, yeah, what's up, Kaze? And then came about, yeah.
I do want to get into also your other profession, which is teaching.
My parents were probably the best teachers I've ever met in my life. And I'm not even just saying that, like objectively, best teachers. But I had it in my blood. Community Prep Academy over in South Central. The student demographic was like 98% African-American. I had a really strong rapport with the students. More than teaching math, I was like a social worker. You know, I was the hip hop club advisor, the ASB advisor, anime club advisor. And so then I established the social student body and, you know, try to get some leadership, and hopefully I've shed some light in that darkness.
Maybe you're living the Nisei dream by helping young people. And
I mean, for me as a Japanese American and like being under the Go for Broke umbrella, it's so dope that like they're bringing all these different factions and people of different backgrounds. I think that's living the Nisei dream.
This time, we're all in it, right? You can't mess with us again.
It's our turn. Like, we gotta raise up, we gotta represent, we gotta be like, yo, what's the point of learning history if we're not actually learning from it?
So we've been saying the phrase go for broke a lot. Basically, go for broke was a Hawaiian gambling phrase. It kind of means go all in. And the Japanese Americans used this phrase to sustain themselves through the war. You know, it's an attitude that got them through tough times. So, you know, think about what go for broke means to you. How are you going to use the attitude of go for broke to persist through your own challenges? Now, until next time, keep on living the Nisei dream.
Oh my gosh, you know, I've never really seen anything like that before. And that's why I really appreciate, again, this type of segment, because it's introduced us to people like Kaze Jones, someone who, you know, is very refreshing in the way that he tells these stories. And he does it in a way that I think appeals to a younger, broader audience. Maybe you want to rap a little bit. Did you have that experience too? Did he make you want to take part in the rap?
Wow. You know what? Yes.
I'm sure you do great. Hopefully we have that on tape somewhere so we can share it with the audience.
You're not shy, you'll keep passing the torch. We've been the next generation since the day we were born. We were meant to live free, this our family. Always going for broke, and yo, we living the dream. And so we keep going, yo, we keep flowing. The legacy of our ancestors will keep growing.
Again, great black male material.
So, Sierra, it must have been such a pleasure to speak with him and interview him. Is there anything in particular that jumps out about your time with Kaze?
You hit the nail on the head. Like, Kaze is such a cool, fun person to be around. And the fact that he had found his way to Go for Broke the way he did and, like, continues to work with Go for Broke.
He was really able to tell the Nisei story through a new avenue. Something like rap, which I know the older generations probably aren't so familiar with, but the younger generations are, you know, it'll really be good for other people who may not have heard of or may not even be interested in the Nisei story had it not been for Kaze Jones. So, and can't wait to see what's next.
Yes, so this next episode was also a super fun one. I grew up going to Little Tokyo all the time, but I actually hadn't really spent much time at this store, been there forever. And the coolest part is, I mean, our guest, she's amazing. So here is the next episode. Please take a look.
And we're about to head into Bunkado, one of the few legacy businesses in Little Tokyo, Los Angeles, owned by the incredible Irene Tsukada Simonian. And she herself actually is the daughter of an MIS veteran.
He was drafted, you know, at the beginning of World War II, and his work was translating in Washington, D.C. After the war ended, he went to Japan to visit his mother, and he met my mother there.
So much Nisei dream to be living. Specifically though, Bunkado is an awesome little shop. There are things in there that I have no idea what they are, so let's go check it out.
My uncle worked as a clerk at a store called Bunkado in the 1920s and encouraged my father and his new bride to come to Little Tokyo, open up a store, and we were not referred to by our names. I was the Bunkado kid.
Kaze Jones, of course, again. He's a hip-hop MC, a school teacher, a multi-talented Shin-Nisei artist, and an all-around cool dude.
So you're a rapper?
MC, yeah. Lyricist.
Demo jitsu wa nihon no hip-hop daihyo samurai mitai na daimyo ore no rap su wa saiko dasai yo te yutte mitara sugu pride on the fight.
But when you think of like an old school sampler, like hip-hop is like very, you know, like they'll sift through and it's like a little, it's like a whole thing.
Oh, Chiaki Naomi.
Chiaki Naomi, super famous. These are karaoke CDs, more cassette tapes, 8-track tapes, anime laser discs.
That's awesome, because like at the school I was teaching at South Central, it was a completely, you know, 90% African-American student demographic. As an anime club advisor, I made the students watch everything in Japanese. So with the subtitles, their literacy dwarfed all the other students in the school.
That is so cool. Yeah. And I have had really young people, maybe they were your students who knew Japanese. They said completely only from watching anime. This is called a furoshiki. This makes a handle and you walk around town. Then you give the whole thing to somebody as a gift. Portable chopstick set. Even has a pocket.
Oh.
Miniature of a Japanese policeman's defensive weapon called a jite. Now we have this miniature of a jite as a keychain.
Oh, weapons as accessories.
Retro robot.
Wow, it's walking!
There's the old traditional wooden kokeshi dolls. Daruma dolls.
Because they kind of look kind of mean, and then there's no pupils in the eyes, so maybe they're kind of like to scare off things?
A monster apple, maybe?
Is a depiction of a Buddhist monk, but he meditated for so long that his legs and arms fell off, and he went blind. You paint one eye when you make a goal for yourself. And when that goal is achieved, you paint the other one. Maneki Neko, very, very popular because it beckons good fortune and money. And Japanese people, for some reason, they don't say, come here. They go, come here. That's what the cat is doing.
Okay.
So who knows what this is?
Oh, you can make, the Buddhists use that for sound, right?
So. Very good, with this stick here.
This is for the true meditators.
Yeah, I mean, I use an app, I don't know.
Wait, that's tanuki.
Tanuki is a little bit controversial. The tanuki is a trickster, sometimes turns into an iron kettle. He's always carrying sake. This is a sake, the big sort of tanuki thing. These things are testicles.
Oh, what? That's crazy.
Beyond that, I cannot explain.
I mean, listen. I know you went into a warehouse with a bunch of tanukis and picked the ones with the best balls, and that's why they're here.
We never saw any of fellow business people as competition. Maybe the camp experience, you know, that people just helped each other. I kind of still sense it today. Looking back at my parents' experience, they kind of didn't have much choice. The Nisei dream that my family wished for me was freedom of choice. You know, freedom to choose where I wanted to live and work. And, you know, it's sort of like the feeling of I'm able to honor the struggles of my parents and what they went through.
Now, until next time, keep on living the Nisei dream. Yay! Staci, what did you think after seeing both segments?
You know, the more I watch both of these segments, the more I really appreciate Go for Broke putting these things together. I mean, like I said, Kaze is just so refreshing in the way that he explains the mission of Go for Broke and its history. And, you know, I when I was watching, again, the Bunkado segment, it really made me think that particularly during this pandemic, it's been so long since I've been to Little Tokyo. I mean, I've gone there for meetings and things like that, but really going shopping in Little Tokyo and the village and everything like that. And I know they're struggling right now. So, you know, I know Irene will be joining us in a little bit, but I hope she can tell us a little bit about, you know, what the reopening of Bunkado looks like in this pandemic.
Yeah, that's such a good point. It is like harrowing seeing, you know, everything there. And for sure, they had a lot of outdoor dining and stuff when we were walking through, but right. it is a very different Little Tokyo, for in more reasons than one. But yeah, okay, great. Well, I mean, what's exciting is we actually have some folks from these segments to join us today. So up first, I wanted to introduce our, you know, a fan favorite, everyone's favorite MC, Kaze Jones is here.
Hey, Kaze, hey. How are you?
It's so good to see you. I think you might be on mute, but it's great to see you. I haven't seen you since we taped all this. How are you feeling watching that back?
I'm good. I'm used to hearing my voice on like a mic on like a hip hop approach. So it's interesting hearing my like academic voice.
It is weird watching ourselves. I think that's always a thing.
Right.
It's like, ooh, is that how I speak? But you're great. So I liked watching you. amazing. And then up next, of course, is Bunkado's very own Irene Tsukada Simonian. Hey!
Hello. Hi,
everybody. Welcome, Irene. Hi.
Thank you. Great to see everybody again.
Thanks for joining us.
Good to see you. What did you think of your segment? And oh, a little Easter egg.
I haven't attained my goal yet, but pretty soon.
Oh, right.
Well, we won't ask if it's private, but good luck on your goal for the year. Yeah, great to see everybody, honestly. Yes.
Amazing.
You, Irene, and you know, like I was just saying, you know, I know that Bunkado is actually coming up on one of its monumental anniversaries, right, this year. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Exactly. This is our 75th anniversary.
Wow.
Congratulations.
Amazing. And we're still here. And I, you know, it means so much to me when I get customers saying, thank you for still being here. And we are. You know, it's been a tough one, man. 2020.
yeah, we all feel that.
Yeah. And then I closed just as a precaution for all of January of this year. Things just sounded too scary to be open for business. So we actually reopened on February 1st. So that officially kicked off our 75th anniversary year. Thank you, Kaze. Yeah, things are looking hopeful. That's all I am. I'm hopeful for this year. Yes.
Amazing. Yeah, those tanukis aren't going to sell themselves, you know? Got to get those guys out there.
Maybe after this segment, they may be flying off the shelf.
I think so.
I think they're a little grounded. They're grounded.
Yeah. Got to lift with your legs. Okay, up next is Go for Broke National Education Center's very own president, Mitch Maki. Hey!
Hey, everybody. Hey, everybody.
Amazing. Look at that hat, too. It's a nice hat you got there.
Go for Broke National Education Center. If you want one, you can get it on gofobroke.com.
Wow.
So good to join all of you.
What did you think rewatching it? I know this has been a long journey, this show, but how does it feel to finally show the world, you know?
It was amazing to watch. And of course, you know, I've seen it many times. I've seen every iteration of it. But, you know, just watching all of you made me realize there's a lot of Nisei Dream out there.
Right. And you know what, Mitch, this in the past year, we've done a couple of different programs together. And when you, Fred, first brought up and proposed living the Nisei Dream, I thought to myself, this is really different than a lot of the other events that we've put on. So for this series in particular, what have you learned or how have you been impacted by living the Nisei Dream?
I've learned a lot, Staci. I mean, when I started this project with everyone, I thought I knew what the Nisei Dream was. I mean, I had my idea about it, but what I've been exposed to is that so many different people have so many perspectives on what the Nisei Dream is. And that's what this show is all about, is looking at the dream from very many different perspectives. And yet this was the generation that, you know, made everything possible for us in the Japanese American community. And this was the generation that, along with all Americans of that generation, created the American dream that so many of us are living today. So it's exciting to hear everyone's take on it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Wow. Totally. Yeah, I guess I'll start off by just thanking everyone watching this live. And we have a lot of chats going on YouTube Live, chat on Facebook. So please share in the comments, you know, where are you watching from? What's your connection to Go for Broke? And also, if you have any questions, we'll hopefully be able to get to some questions too later. So yeah, and then this is kind of, you know, this is our after show chat. Obviously, living the Nisei Dream, we just watched two segments, but we're going to also be, you know, it's a series, so we're going to be releasing three new segments with different guests this year. So hang tight. And a very exciting portion of this that we kind of, Staci and I, we kind of dropped this earlier, but basically, you know, Mitch's cameo throughout, this is a very important part of the series. Hopefully everybody has paid attention to the detail here, but the segment is called, or the challenge really is called Make Mike. And the story behind that, the name Mike is Japanese. It's a slang word that's Mike Mono, meaning good find. Or as Staci, as you termed it, it's kind of like Where's Waldo-esque type thing. And so the first 10 people who are able to find Mitch Make Mike in the second episode, if you guys could email us at takeaction@goforbroke.org, tell us either the timestamp in the subject line or just describe where you saw him in this segment, you get to win a Living the Nisei Dream shirt, which I have right here. I didn't iron it because I am living in a pandemic, but yeah, here it is. you know, certain things fall by the wayside, but it's still beautiful. It really doesn't need to be ironed, honestly. It's a very resilient shirt. I also have this shirt on, too. You don't get to win this one, but you can buy that at goforbroke.com, along with Mitch's hat and many other goodies. But anyway, so if you want to win this awesome Living the Nisei Dream shirt, make sure you email where you saw him, and then also, so you can do that now, or you can do it over the weekend and another 10 will be chosen at random over the weekend. So, you know, many chances to get free clothing. And then we'll announce winners on Monday, March 1st.
Sierra?
Yes.
Yeah. So I'm wearing my hat and I'm wearing this t-shirt as a hint for everyone.
Ooh.
That's all I'll say. But so good.
Whoa.
T-shirt, everyone.
Nice. Mitch, hey, everybody. Trying to...
Why I'm losing sleep at night. I have a brand new puppy. His name is Kuma, which means, of course, bear.
Bear.
looks like there because he doesn't have a tail, because that's the thing. But isn't he cute?
Oh, my goodness.
A brand new addition to my family.
Oh, hi, Kuma.
Kuma, wow. Hello. That's the dream right there. you're living my Nisei dream.
Kuma's getting more positive comments in the chat than any of us here.
I mean, yeah. Shut down the show.
A puppy, I swear to God.
Adorable. I mean, speaking of puppies and, if you want to maybe meet this puppy, you could go to Bunkado. Maybe he'll be there. No, I don't know. Do you bring him to work?
Yes. Well, he is going to be coming to work, and he already has a nickname, Bunkadog.
I'm ashamed I didn't think about myself. That's
so cute.
I love it. Bunkadog. Yeah.
Bunkadog. I mean,
Kaze, if I can ask you a question, because I've been wondering this, sharing your episode with a lot of your folks in the hip hop crowd, what's been their reaction?
I actually haven't shared it as much because I didn't want to ruin the premiere. But my parents saw it. I think they're pretty impressed because they remember maybe like, how long ago is it? We did Go for Broke maybe a couple years ago. Probably 4 years ago was the NHK when they aired the tribute to Daniel Inouye, Senator Daniel Inouye. And they're like, oh my gosh, like, you're trying to incorporate education with hip hop. Like this, you should do a song about history, Japanese American history. I was like, man, I don't know. And then when I actually got to work with Shane Sato and of course, GFBNEC, and then I actually did the song. They're like, oh, like, that sounds cool. My parents are the ones that actually found the sample of the original, I forget what it was called, but it was like an old Japanese flute. And it was based off of a song. It was post-war. So I'm the post-war generation. I thought it'd be like a cool underlying deep meaning to the song. And then after I watched the tribute, I literally thought he was one of the last true American heroes. Like the whole story of Go From Broke and the fact that he did it when he lost his arm. You listen to how that man spoke. He spoke and he had like this very strong presence to him. Like nothing but respect. And you could hear like the honor that followed him. So I just, I watched a bunch of documentaries on him. They did a drunk history segment on him, which is like a really funny show. I just got kind of obsessed with it. And then the more and more I've collaborated with you guys, I had the Never Again Is Now song. I collaborated with Kimiko Mar. It's been a really dope experience. I actually did a case study with UCLA and you guys, and I did like a little mini video documentary about it. And it's been very empowering. So when I was growing up when I was younger, I was always trying so hard to assimilate to American culture. So not quite Caucasian or white enough, but not quite Japanese enough. I wasn't Nihonjin enough. Like if you listen to my Japanese, it's still kind of like a little childish, right? You know what I mean? I've only gotten scolded in Japanese. So a lot of my Japanese friends had to move back to the homeland, when everyone got displaced with Toyota and all that. So very Americanized. And the Go for Broke was like a new, it was a breath of fresh air, a second wind for me to kind of get back to the community, get back to the cultural side aspect. So, yeah.
Yeah, it sounds like you're living the Nisei dream, brother.
Oh, yeah, every day, all day.
Yes. Oh, wait, we did get a little question here from the audience. And I might toss this to you, Mitch, because I know we've talked about this. Will we be doing some segments in Hawaii?
Yeah, you know it. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Very exciting. Yeah.
Literally, we're looking at going across the nation to different places to hear the stories, getting way outside of Los Angeles. I can tell you, I've already made some contacts in Hawaii, and we have some people we're identifying. We just got to get past this pandemic. And we're going to be out there.
Yeah, don't we all? I feel that. I mean, yeah, I think what's very exciting is there's just so much. Actually, I might talk about what we're looking at releasing next.
And our next segment will be released in April, and that's going to be with special guest Alec Nakashima, who is an apparel designer. He founded Akashikama, if anyone's familiar. They have some really cool pieces. And I know Gopher Broke, you all collaborated with him in releasing a new line of apparel. So you can also check out that clothing line at gopherbroke.com. And you know, and I mean, I think also with these first two segments, what's really cool is like, it does give a sample of like what we'll see in the future, but also it'll be like very different. So I think if you're at all interested in what you saw, please share with family and friends. Irene, I also wanted to defer to you on a couple fun things from Bunkado that are available on the gopherbroke.com website. Among them, the Tanuki, as everybody loves so dearly, but anything else you want to shout out?
Yes, a lot of the things that were featured in that segment, the little jute keychain, the police weapon, and the furoshiki cloth for wrapping, the daruma, the maneki, and not only the original tanuki that you saw, the anatomically correct tanuki, but we have a little cute baby tanuki also for sale that will be available through Gopher Broke's first collaboration with a another organization, and it's just so meaningful for me because my father was in military intelligence service and served during World War II as a translator. It's so fantastic that we have this connection. And Kaze, yes, you bought an LP of vinyl from Bunkado. Oh, a bunch of them.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
All right, I did that backwards. I haven't got to listen to all of them, but yeah, she got vinyls on deck. So hit up Bunkado. It's really hard to find like old school Japanese records. So I got really excited when we did the segment.
Yeah, the treasure trove. I also want to shout out some folks who are watching, a lot of whom have family who served, and shout out to Nancy Seri, who said her uncle served and died with the 442nd while his family was interned at Tule Lake. So thank you for his service. And also so many people watching across the country. I saw someone is from Bronx in Pasadena, way out in Pasadena. No, that's very close to where I'm at right now. Bainbridge Island, Sylvania, Ohio. Cool. All these cool places. So thanks for joining us.
Sierra, can you see how the chat room is just blowing up with Bunkado? I mean,
listen, Bunkado is a revelation.
Bunkado's got to happen now, okay?
You have to capitalize on Bunkado. Cash in. This is
we got Oda the rapper. Oda the rapper's tuned in. She helped. she helped me out. She's the second person on the intro song. So the intro theme song. Her and the homie Jesse Bias, who's actually African-American, but he lived in Japan, so he raps in Japanese. So we have a whole new project, and this is the thing that kind of kick-started it off. So very excited. Yeah, be on the lookout for Ichizoku. What up, Oda?
So I brought my Bunkado also.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm taking a look at the chat here, and I see a lot of the Kizuna folk out there. Shout out to everyone from Kizuna. I see Kristen, Stephanie, everyone there. They want some Bunkado merch. So, Irene, I think you're going to have to incorporate that into your shop.
Yeah, you gotta get another store going.
Yep.
Wow.
Amazing. I have some other questions for some of you all while we're all together. I know, Staci, you're very active in the community, and as you share with younger Japanese Americans and other friends, what part of like the Nisei veteran story resonates with you the most? Because I think that's a challenge that we're trying to, meet with this series.
Right. I think really what a lot of it has to do with, in the Go for Broke mission, it really talks about the valor and the courage of the World War II veterans. And I know I've shared this with a couple of internal Go for Broke members, but maybe not with the broader audience. But my husband's family comes from a line of Japanese American veterans. And so it really means a lot to me that we're doing a series like this that expands the mission to a lot of just a broader audience. So it may be younger people out there. It might be aspiring, you know, military soldiers, or I have a cousin right now who's at Annapolis, so he's going to be in the Navy soon. So it really just tells the story of what the veterans have done for us, what we're allowed, what opportunities we've been given as a result. And my cousin was saying, you know, a couple of months ago that he and my uncle, who was also in the Navy, they were really grateful for the vets who had served, particularly, you know, the 442 MIS, because they said without those individuals, they wouldn't be able to be in the military right now, or be in the positions, or attain the level in the military that they had. So they were really grateful for the people who served before us. And that really, you know, is what living the Nisei Dream is about. It's giving us these opportunities that we wouldn't have had if it hadn't been for their sacrifice, for their courage, for their valor. So this series in particular does mean a lot to me, and I can't wait to see, you know, what else we can learn from other individuals. Because, you know, Kaze, I really appreciate, you know, your music. And I have a younger sister with a big age difference, but she's only 15 right now. And so I know, as you know, as the generations become further and further removed from World War II, and as the veterans or the survivors pass on, they're not going to have that same connection, you know, because they're not going to be able to hear the stories directly from the horse's mouth. So for them to be able to hear it in, you know, a different avenue, like rap, like hip hop, that's something that's going to interest them, and it's going to spark this movement. Like, you know, well, what is the 442? What happened? What's internment? So I really appreciate what you've done with your series. So thank you so much.
Yeah, I mean, there was one song. It was Kenji by the rapper from Linkin Park. Yeah. I forget what his name was. Yeah, but that was a really famous one. That was the only one I had growing up. So, you know, now it could be your second choice. Learning about our history, so.
Right, variety.
Choices, just two, yeah.
I mean, part of the Nisei Dream is freedom of choice, Irene, right?
There you go.
I loved that quote, that really resonates. But I also wanna say, as far as, you know, if you guys wanna get this t-shirt for free, freedom of choice of this t-shirt, make sure you watch again and find Mitch and send in either where you see him or the timestamp to takeaction@goforbroke.org. And then, you know, you could be one of the lucky 10 to get this t-shirt, or the second 10 to get the t-shirt. So many, many possibilities. I'll also toss this to you, Kaze. Apparently someone, Nancy Isere, says if she can get your email info, she can let you know if any of her dad's Japanese music tapes, laser discs, are still around.
Oh, I was looking at myself in the camera and my jaw dropped. I was like, yeah. Toss it over.
Okay. Well, let me know. That communication is bridged. Amazing. Please.
Sierra, we'll be sure to post information about Kaze and Bunkado and Irene on our website, so if people them or want to know more about them, they can just come to our website and we'll information about them.
Amazing. And then, yeah, as far as getting to the series in the future, I mean, the YouTube channel will continue to upload, I'm assuming, the series there. I guess this live premiere is unique. I don't know if this is going to be, I guess, uploaded anywhere, but I think Facebook Live, it lives on Facebook for a bit. So pretty much sharing goforbroke.org, sharing the Facebook page or the YouTube channel will then always constantly update as, yes, a confirmation on that. It will stay on YouTube and Facebook. So yeah, so just point any friends or family who might be interested in watching all this to those links, and then they'll, you know, be constantly updated once we get more segments up, or if they want to watch past segments, it'll be there too. So, yeah.
You know, Sierra, the other thing I'd welcome people to do is if they have any ideas of who we should be interviewing or what stories we should be telling, we would welcome that too. Because, you know, we don't have a lock on the Nisei Dream, and there's so much Nisei Dream, as you put it, out there. So people can write into us and say, hey, go interview so-and-so, and, you know, we can see if we can line it up.
Oh, yeah. Totally, yeah.
Mitch, and I really love the fact that you called it living the Nisei dream, you know, because that generation went through an amazing sort of tragic but exciting and everything else all combined in one. They were the first generation to be born in the United States. Their parents were from Japan. And then they lived through World War II. And so many of them, you know, served in the service under very difficult circumstances. And also, you know, we have Nisei Week. And it'll never, ever be called anything other than Nisei Week, no matter what generation it will be in the future. Sierra's already fourth generation, but, you know, we still have our Nisei Week. And, it's a very significant part of our lives.
Right. And you know what else, Irene, is I have a number of very dear friends who are Shin-Nisei, and we referred to that in one of the segments. And in fact, Kaze is Shin-Nisei, and for those in the audience who don't really know what that is, it's for Japanese Americans whose family came after the war, you know, to the United States. And what's so amazing is that when my Shin-Nisei friends watch this, they identify, you know, and we as a community need to embrace all their stories, all of our stories, you know, whether it's the camps, whether it's the veterans, whether it's our Japanese Americans who came after the war, because their stories go through World War II, but it's on the other side of the Pacific. Yeah. And I think living the Nisei dream encapsulates all of that.
Yep.
Well, I didn't realize, Kaze, that your family was Shin-Nikkei. So I guess, you know, for you in particular, since that's your family background, what is your message to not only just the Shin-Nikkei community, but also to our Yonsei and Gosei and future generations of Japanese Americans?
What do you mean in regards to message?
Is there anything that you want to let them know? Is there anything that you want to share about what living the Nisei dream means to you, or just any advice that you have for future generations?
I guess something I've been doing a lot recently, even with Kimiko Mara, we had the whole the Never Again Is Now movement. Especially like right now is a really big time where, you know, everything, there's not just one revolution. I think my professor from UCLA had always said, if you're a true revolutionary, you need to be down with all the causes kind of thing. It shouldn't just be one. It shouldn't just be about, you know, the ICE detention and abolish ICE. It's not just about, you know, Black Lives Matter. It's just, we got to be about all of that. You know, it all comes down to humanization. I think a lot of us are, you know, there are those certain parties of people who are just being dehumanized. They're not treated like human beings, whatever that may be, you know, and that's all over the world. It's not just on our soil. And, you know, there's just little things that you could do, like even right, like probably right after this, my student that I'm mentoring, he wasn't allowed any opportunities for extracurricular. So he made his own little club, and he got it okay by the school, but we're doing philanthropy. We're cleaning up the beaches. Just, you know, there's not too many people. It's social distancing, you know, and that's like his own little revolution. Like, you know, he wants to enjoy our beautiful landscapes that are local to us, but have respect for it. And then hopefully that it might build up to something where it's even bigger than his own high school. And he put it on Craigslist, and we're meeting up some random person in Long Beach, and we're going to start picking up trash. Whatever. And it, you know, and I, who cares, but like, we're doing something about it. We're acting upon it. So whatever someone feels strongly in their heart and their soul, do something about it. Just get up and get out there. Yeah. You know, of course, safely and lawfully, but yeah, like if you really about a revolution, get up and get out.
You know, Kaze, that was really deep, man. And it really speaks. And I know we're on this show today, the five of us and all of the audience, and we're having a great time. This is so much fun. But I'm also cognizant, and I want to give a shout out and recognition to our friends and family at Higashi Hongwanji Buddhist Church, Buddhist Temple. And for those of you who may not have heard, you know, the temple was vandalized Thursday night. And it just breaks my heart. I know it's gotten a lot of us very angry, very sad, but it's as we live that Nisei dream, as we live our existence, we got to make sure that we stand together with all parts of our community. And again, so to our friends and family at Higashi, you know, we're thinking of you. Let us know what we need to do for you. Let us know what you need, and Go for Broke is there for you.
Yes, it is. It is a very I guess we didn't time it this way, but the fact that this is all coming out now is I think very relevant. But yeah, I don't know if anybody else wants to also answer that same question. Maybe Irene, if you had a message to throw out there to the Yonsei or Gosei or Shin-Nikkei generations.
Yeah, you know, the thing with the community, it really is like a family. I feel that every day that I'm there, how powerful the connections are with each other. And I honestly believe that it was the experience of post-camp and maybe, you know, during World War II. And the only way the community survived is because we worked together. And as I said in the tape segment, we didn't consider ourselves competitors, you know, because there was so much help going on between businesses and your friends and your family. And I honestly still feel it today, you know, that when I see, especially, you know, it was evident during the pandemic, but how much the community came forward and helped each other. And even, you know, whether it was the organized thing, like the community feeding community program and the other food programs that just came on board, but even individual businesses helped each other. You know, it was just this cross current of help and assistance. And I think that that's ingrained in Little Tokyo, and I'm proud to be part of it. You know, it's something my parents taught me to do, and I hope with the younger generations that's really there and very strong.
Oh yeah, yeah. I've been following Little Tokyo's kind of journey on Instagram specifically, just because I can't visit as in person anymore. But it seems like, you know, such a community, and that's been really inspiring, I think, especially now. Another fun little tidbit here. Apparently this logo, the Living the Nisei Dream cursive, was written by a Nisei. Very beautiful handwriting, I must say. So again, get your t-shirts.
Hey, Sierra, if I could ask Kaze a question, or really ask him to do something, you know, I really enjoyed your rap. It was really well put together in so many different ways. But what I liked most about it is the first stanza, if you will, Yiddishai, and then if you could share the words with everyone, because I don't know if they caught it this time around, you know.
Hold on.
You gotta look it up.
I have like 5 projects, so I apologize.
It's the part where you're saying, you know, we're the next generation from the day.
Right. So it goes.
That Sierra got the rap too. So.
Oh yeah. I also, read it completely. Yeah.
So it goes, Irashai, Yoki passing the torch. We the next generation since the day we were born. We were meant to live free. This our family, always going for broke. Yo, we living the dream.
Say it one more time, and because I think I really want people to get the essence of those words. I mean, they're really deep.
Irashai, Yoki passing the torch. We the next generation since the day we were born. We were meant to live free. This our family, always going for broke. Yo, we living the dream. And so we keep going. Yo, we keep flowing. The legacy of our ancestors will keep growing. Samurai blow with an American twist. It's death before dishonor. This the way that we live. Irashai, if you don't know, means like welcome. And it kind of goes back to the Bunkado episode. Right, the little cat, the Maneki Neko, right? Get yours at Bunkado. Go stop by there and cop yourself a little Maneki Neko. But yeah, I was trying to like encompass just like, you know, I think we as a culture are very welcoming. I don't want to say servile, but I mean, we're very inviting. And it's you know, like I think the American way, like the customer is always right, is like a slogan we have in America. But in Japan, it's like 10 times more extreme and intense, right? You're making them more than a family. You're treated like almost in a divine manner, right? Everything's very organized, and you know, we have your ocha with a sembe, and it's very decorated. And you know, this is one thing I learned recently about welcoming. My mom said everything that you plate needs to be high, like agateru. And that is like a form of like respect and like presentation where everything. So if you notice a lot of Japanese food, the plating, it'll be like sit up kind of escalated a little bit. I don't know. I don't know why I went on that tangent, but yeah. So Yonsei, and keep passing the torch. If you notice that the Go for Broke logo, I wanted to incorporate as much as I could all the different aspects and perspectives of Go for Broke. And so keep passing the torch. You know, even for myself, I feel like I'm getting older. I'm kind of losing touch with this newer generation. So hip hop will always be a part of my life, but we got to definitely school the youngins. We got to check them. We got to provide perspective and show them through a different lens, through an older lens, and kind of bridge that gap and combine all the different generations together. Keep moving forward.
Can I add something? Because there was a question from the audience about the Texas Lost Battalion, the 141st Infantry, and if there were stories that were passed down. I have a very intriguing and very moving, touching story because there was a picture that flashed up in the Bunkado segment that we just saw. It was a black and white picture of people sitting watching the Nisei Week parade go by. If you look at it again, there is a Caucasian couple sitting amongst all the Japanese audience members. And I always find it intriguing. Who were they? And they're the only ones with chairs. So I asked my sister if she knew anything about them. And she told me this story that was passed down. And I wasn't paying attention because I was kind of a bratty kid in the family. That couple, the gentleman in that picture, was in the Texas Battalion. And he came every year back in, that picture was taken in 1953, I think. He came to the Nisei Week Parade every year so he could stand at attention and salute as the veterans of the 442nd marched in the parade. And my aunt and uncle found out about that story and they said, you have a place of honor in front of our store in these chairs and you're always welcome here anytime. And to me, that's such a touching story for so many, on so many levels. So if you look back at the video, you'll see that couple sitting there.
Yeah, for those in the audience who may not know the full story, there was 211 white Texas soldiers that were trapped behind enemy lines in northern France. And the 442nd was the only unit that could get in there, break them out, and save them. And so we hear stories like the one that Irene just told of these soldiers and their families still to this day being grateful for what the Japanese American soldiers did during World War II. Great story, Irene. Great story.
Wow, yeah. So powerful. Well, I mean, I don't think we can top that, honestly. So we might have to wrap up. But beautiful. I mean, I learned so much. I continue to learn so much from you all through this series. Thank you so much for, you know, being here and including me in this project, Living the Nisei Dream. To everyone watching, thank you. Also want to shout out Janice and Shreve, the video production team who made this possible. Janice Tanji Wong, who we worked with, who obviously is, you know, the force in Go for Broke making this happen. So thank you to everybody. And again, yes, take action at goforbroke.org. Tell us where you saw Mitch. Get your t-shirt. Subscribe on YouTube and like on Facebook for more updates and share, please. So thank you. Have a wonderful rest of your weekend.
Thing. Oh, yes. We're going to be doing a beach cleanup in downtown Long Beach off Junipero. I'm literally going right now. If you guys are in the area, if you guys are free, my mentee that I'm working with, he's kind of doing it to get his college apps ready and, you know, make an impact on the community. So if you're free, you're in the area, we're social distancing, you want to help out, we're cleaning up at downtown Long Beach.
Amazing. The dream. All right. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everyone.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Peace. Thank you.